Speaker. Great to see you in the chair. I thank my right honourable friend for his very constructive engagement with the government on this important issue. The government has recently announced, as he will be aware, a package of financial support for English airports and ground handlers. This support, which will shore up jobs and reinforce local economies, will be equivalent to the business rates liabilities of each business up to a maximum of £8 million per site, and has been warmly welcomed by the Airport Operators Association.
Bradley.
Mr. Speaker, can I thank the Minister for that additional support for regional airports? It's very welcome. But the steps taken by the government generally to move a small distance towards reopening the aviation sector last week go nowhere near to what is needed. We face a situation in January, Mr. Speaker, when the Brexit transition period is open, but our principal airports and our principal aviation links to key business centres around the world will effectively still be closed. Please can I urge the Chancellor and the Minister to use every influence they have in government to get that dealt with, and at least to get airport testing and what is necessary available on those key strategic routes.
Well, my right honourable friend is absolutely right to focus on testing. As he will be aware, the test-to-release regime combines a much shorter self-isolation period with a real focus on public health. And of course, as you'll also know from the Global Travel Task Force report, we as a country are continuing to explore pre-departure testing with partner countries on a bilateral basis, including different models by which that might be delivered.
15 withdrawn, so we have a substantive question to the Chancellor. Number 60.
Mr. Speaker, the economic impacts of coronavirus and the substantial fiscal support provided has meant a necessary increase in our deficit and debt levels this year. That is the right thing to do to combat the pandemic. But once the economic recovery begins and uncertainty recedes, we will, of course, return our public finances to a sustainable and strong position.
Let's head to Central Devon with the Chair of the Treasury Committee, Mel Stride. Mel Stride.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, there are reports that the Treasury has created an economic impact analysis providing significant detail on the effect of coronavirus across the various sectors of the economy. For each sector, this analysis allocates red, amber, and green ratings for revenue, jobs, and financial stability. Given the vote tonight, could I ask my right honourable friend why this analysis has not been published?
Mr. Speaker, my honourable friend will have seen, obviously, the analysis we did publish. It did talk specifically about sectoral impact, and in the document there were specific links to the various places that people can find a GVA and employment by sector, and indeed financial resilience of local businesses at some stages by sector, by region. It's that analysis, as we said, which will determine the particular economic impact in an area. That information is all provided in the report for people to look at.
Verse 17, please, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. With permission, Mr. Speaker, I'd like to answer this question with questions 18, 19 and 20. As my honourable friend will be aware, the government's taken unprecedented support steps to support the self-employed during this crisis. That includes through the Self-Employed Income Support Scheme, which has been extended up till April, with details of the third grant published last week.
Mr. Speaker, many self-employed people are at the forefront of innovation and start-ups. Can my honourable friend tell me what Treasury is doing to support innovation as we look to rebuild our economy?
Well, she's absolutely right about the importance of innovation, and she'll be delighted to know that the government is protecting innovators and start-ups from the impact of COVID through almost £900 million of future fund loans to date, £79 million for innovation loans, as well as other grants. And that comes on top of over £5 billion of support through R&D tax credits claimed for 2018-19 so far, which support over £35 billion worth of R&D expenditure.
Let's head to Essex with Stephen Metcalf. Stephen Metcalf.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Can I thank my right honourable friend for all he has done so far to support the self-employed, but ask that he keep an open mind when it comes to future support. As you will be aware, millions have benefited from the schemes he has introduced, but there is a minority who have not. As the pandemic is lasting longer than we had imagined, will he look again at what else can be done for those who have had no income now for 9 months?
I thank my honourable friend for his question, and I should make perfectly clear to him, as the Chancellor has, that we take these points extremely seriously. We have been given many different suggestions over the past few months for ways in which we could accommodate these concerns. We've looked at them very closely, and so far we have struggled to find one that meets the need to avoid the fraud risk that bedevils this concern. I will also say to him that I wrote, or at least I responded last week to a request, the latest request to meet from the Federation of Small Business and ACCA and Forgotten Limited to explore the latest of these schemes. I've also said that I would be happy, as the Chancellor's mentioned, to meet the APPG alongside Excluded UK to address these very questions.
Soundbound.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Could the Minister say when the recently announced increase in the CBILS term from 6 to 10 years will come into effect, as this is of particular importance to businesses which have been hard hit by the crisis, such as the wedding venue and hospitality sectors in Clwyd South and elsewhere in the UK?
Well, we of course recognise the concerns he raises. We should be clear that the purpose of this extension is not simply to allow borrowers to request a 10-year term. It is that the guarantee offered by the government on these schemes should be extended up to 10 years where lenders deem that as a forbearance tool that borrowers may need and benefit from. My colleagues are working at pace with the British Business Bank to implement the policy in line with state aid rules.
Sir Robert Neil.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Does my honourable friend accept that self-employed people and freelancers, many of whom are formed as limited companies, not because they choose to, but because the agencies they work for or the contractors they work for have required them to do so, or insurers have required them to do so, continue to fall through the net? Is it perhaps a good idea for him to meet directly with some of those who work in these sectors? Because I suspect many of those who advise him in the Treasury have no understanding of how self-employment actually works.
Well, I'm grateful, my honourable friend, for his question. As he'll be aware, I have had a history of being very closely involved with the performing arts sector, and as I've indicated to him, I will be meeting with many of the groups representing people in this situation. He should be aware, of course, that in addition to the £1.57 billion Culture Recovery Fund that the Chancellor has already mentioned, the government has also put in place a film and TV insurance scheme for which there has been over 150 applications made so far. So it does take these issues, and it continues to take these issues extremely seriously.
Shadow Minister of Pongasari.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The situation for the self-employed is especially difficult in areas with additional restrictions and working in the hardest hit sectors. The government's additional restrictions grants must go further in areas that have been in restrictions for longer. What plans does the government have to improve this situation?
Well, the Honourable Lady will be aware that we've backdated business grants in order to address some of these concerns. But it's also worth mentioning that the third phase alone of the self-employed scheme is expected to take cost over £7 billion. And so it's a part of a wider package, as the Chancellor has said, of support that we're trying to give to businesses and individuals who are affected by the crisis.
We've got a substantive question to Minister Bednall. Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The government is supporting the development of the early fuel cell electric vehicle market through the £23 million Hydrogen for Transport programme. The spending review also confirmed an automotive transformation fund to help industry transition to low carbon vehicles. Also at the spending review, the Chancellor announced £240 million over the next 4 years to support the aim of 5 gigawatts of low-carbon hydrogen by 2030.
Let's head to Lichfield with Michael Fabricant. Michael Fabricant.
I thank my honourable friend for her answer. The West Midlands Rail Executive and I are both very keen to re-establish the Lichfield to Burton railway line, which currently is used just for freight traffic, for passenger traffic. It'll stop too at the National Memorial Arboretum. And the plan is that the locomotives will be fuel cell hydrogen powered. Doesn't my honourable friend agree with me that the Levelling Up Fund would be an ideal fund for this project?
Minister.
Mr. Speaker, my honourable friend is, as ever, a great champion for his local area. I understand Transport for West Midlands, in partnership with Staffordshire Council and the local rail executive, have already engaged with the Restoring Your Railways Fund regarding the specific proposal that he's referencing. And the Department of Transport has announced there'll be a further round of bidding for the fund, which they should be able to participate in. Other aspects of the proposal may be eligible for support from the £4 billion Levelling Up Fund, which he mentions, and the government will set out more details on eligibility in due course.
23 withdrawn, so we go to Sammy Wilson.
Majesty's Revenue and Customs are aware of 15 contractors who have used disguised remuneration schemes while engaged either by the department or by Revenue and Customs Digital Technology Services. In each of the cases, the contractors were engaged via an agency or a company providing the service. It's important to be clear that the Revenue and Customs do not engage in or enter into disguised remuneration schemes. It's possible for a contractor providing services to HMRC to use a disguised scheme without the department's knowledge or participation through a third party.
Sammy Wilson.
I must say I'm amazed at the answer that the Minister has given, that firms can use methods of payments which HMRC then declare to be illegal, and no checks have been done by HMRC on those contractors. But does he not accept that it is unfair to put the burden on taxpayers who, first of all, entered into payments because through disguised remuneration because they were forced to do? They declared that on their tax returns and HMRC didn't challenge it, and now HMRC are telling us that they didn't even check that contractors who were employed by themselves were paying in that way. How many of these contractors have the Treasury, or have HMRC actually pursued for forcing employees to use schemes which have been deemed illegal?
Well, I think my friend's slightly unclear on this. The HMRC take careful steps to ensure that people who deal with them as agencies employ on a proper and appropriate basis. When, in very rare cases, amongst hundreds and hundreds of contractors, it may, in a fast-moving market, it may become clear that someone has in fact been hired on this basis, they take immediate steps to follow up, to end that relationship, and then to follow up, of course, as may be required under law to pursue it. And if he's interested in the interest of taxpayers, may I remind him that many of the people who benefit from disguised remuneration have not been paying tax from which our public services benefit, and it's those taxpayers whose interests we are also seeking to protect.
Stephen Hammond.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Number 25, please, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The Revenue and Customs have been clear on their commitment to support all taxpayers who may need help paying their loan charge liabilities. Where someone cannot afford to pay in full on time, they will seek to agree payment by instalments. They have a dedicated helpline for those seeking to leave avoidance schemes, and their disguised remuneration and debt management teams are trained to identify taxpayers who may need extra help and support and to refer them, if necessary, to outside organisations for support as well.
Stephen Hammond.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And as my right honourable friend rightly recognises, there are a number of people who cannot pay the amount, either in full at the beginning or in instalments. Given that now the HMRC has recognised that many of these people were victims of mis-selling, is it not time to have another review of the people who have been mis-sold these schemes? And is it not right and appropriate that those who mis-sold the schemes make some contribution to those demands?
As my friend will be aware, we've had a long and detailed review process conducted by Sir Amias Morse. It is, of course, the individual's responsibility to ensure the accuracy of their tax returns and to understand the consequences of their decisions, although, of course, the government does very much sympathise with people who have been caught in that position. I would also say to him that he may have noticed we've been taking very vigorous action against promoters of tax avoidance schemes. Most recently, an announcement we made last week that HMRC and the Advertising Standards Authority are getting together to crack down on misleading promoting of tax avoidance schemes.
Let's head to Ealing North with James Murray. James Murray.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Following the loan charge review, the government promised in March that this year would bring both legislation and the announcement of additional policy measures against those who promote tax avoidance schemes. As neither have happened, can the minister now confirm when all the promised changes will become law?
Well, I thank the Honourable Member for his question, and we will be making an announcement about the response to the Amos Morse review shortly.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Question 27, please.
The government recognises the extreme disruption that the pandemic has had on business, employment and the nation's economy, and our goal remains to